down to nothing when it detaches. But that's not the situation I have for the even and odd representation in the last problem there. So the even spectrum goes up to a unitarity limit, the odd one goes down to zero, but half the sum of the two, which is giving you the left or the right conductance, just doesn't see the crossover to the Fermi liquid state at all. So you think you're saying, indeed you are saying the way you've constructed it, the two-channel Condor 6-point, even in the frequency regime where technically speaking it's unstable.
The fact that sum is just three-point two-channel, can it be a certain signature of the channel?
Yes, it should be. It's precisely the case. If I have my chain of any length, and I have a symmetric current going through here, in other words, I preserve the left-right symmetry of the problem, then that is a signature of the effect itself. Yes. Yes, directly.
Okay,
we are privileged to give this talk here. In fact, this is an area where we started working about 3 years back. And this was under direct encouragement of Professor Ramakrishnan, who sort of explained us the problem and provided, of course, very delightful insight when we got along with this work. Okay, so first let me show the people who actually did this work. These are the students and postdocs here. We have a very active collaboration with these three theorists, Vikram Tripathi in TIFR, Lara Benfato in Rome, and Bert Siebold in Germany. I forget the name of the institute. And we, as you will see, we have a very strong instrumentation activity. This instrumentation activity is done in direct collaboration with a company in Mumbai called Excel Instruments, headed by someone called Subhash Pai. And I will show some of the things that we did as we get along. Okay, so first to start with, to explain the problem that I will be dealing with, let me give you a very brief description of the BCS, of our understanding of superconductivity from BCS theory. So within BCS theory, we know that if you have two electrons on the Fermi surface with opposite momentum and spin, then they can get bound through an infinitesimally small attractive interaction, and that gives rise to a singlet state, which we call as Cooper pair. These singlet states, they are boson-like objects, so they can condense into a phase-locked state below a characteristic temperature or at T equal to zero, and that gives you superconductivity. So the order parameter of a superconductor is described by a complex function like this. You have the amplitude delta, which is nothing but the binding energy of this singlet state, and this binding energy leads to an energy gap in the electronic spectrum. So if you look at the electronic spectrum, there is a gap close to Fermi level, and if you unbind these electrons, then you don't, then you again see states above the gap. And this phase of the condensate, which is actually coherent over the entire size of the superconductor, this is what is responsible for the zero resistance state. Now one can go to finite temperature and do a mean field approximation to find the temperature dependence of this binding energy of this singlet state, in other words, the superconducting energy gap. And this is a measurable quantity that we can measure from electron tunneling. And if we do that, what we observe is that this gap gradually decreases with increasing temperature and goes to zero at a characteristic temperature. And this blue curve that you see here is the resistance of the material. And you see that the resistance is exactly at the same temperature where the binding energy of these Cooper pairs have gone to zero. In other words, we don't have any more Cooper pairs. So within BCS theory, this was almost considered a central paradigm of superconductivity, that the TC of a superconductor is associated with the temperature where the superconducting energy gap goes to zero. This central paradigm was, however, questioned after the discovery of the high TC cube plates. So You have here the celebrated high-DC phase diagram. And if you stay, for example, at a particular doping and do a tunneling measurement as a function of temperature, you see that the superconducting gap does not close at TC, but actually keeps persisting up to a temperature which can be many times TC. So this was questioning the central paradigm of BCS theory, and there is, I think, so far no consensus on the origin of the pseudo gap. However, we could think of one plausible scenario. Whether this plausible scenario is valid in high TC or not, I don't know. But the plausible scenario is this. Suppose the order parameter of the superconductor has this amplitude and this phase, and BCS theory just considers this amplitude, and when the amplitude goes to zero, it associates that temperature with TC. Suppose the amplitude does not go to zero, but because of thermal or quantum phase fluctuation, the phase coherence of the condensate is lost, then you would also destroy the zero resistance state. And in such a situation, the state that you have between TC and the temperature where this gap in the electronic spectrum disappears, which is known as the pseudo gap state, this would be a state which comprises of phase incoherent Cooper pairs or phase incoherent pairs. So the question that we are going to ask today is not whether this scenario is strictly applicable to high temperature superconductors, but rather if this scenario is plausible, this should even be reasonable for for conventional superconductors, and can we observe a pseudo gap state in a conventional superconductor which does not have the complexity of the high TC cube rates in terms of the underlying Mott insulating state and the magnetic and charge correlations that exist in a high TC. Okay, so for this, but I told you that for most conventional superconductor, BCS theory is eminently valid, and phase fluctuation does not play any significant role. So let's try to understand why. It's not difficult to understand. For that, what we have to calculate is the energy cost of providing a twist in the phase in a superconductor. This is called the superfluid stiffness, and this superfluid stiffness can be very simply estimated. If you know the superfluid density, which is the number of super electrons, which is proportional to 1 by the penetration depth square. So this is the superfluid density, these are universal constants. So if you hear the superfluid stiffness, two papers, this is going to appear soon. So why are we looking at strong disorder? What does strong disorder do? The first thing which strong disorder do is that in the presence of strong disorder, your screening becomes less effective. So therefore, the electron-electron repulsive interaction increases, and this partially compensates the electron-phonon attractive interaction, and this leads to a suppression of both delta and TC. So you have an effective weakening of the pairing interaction. This was shown by Anderson, Mutali, Ramakrishnan in 1983 and later by Finkelstein in 1994 for in two-dimensional systems. Now, this effect will not cause any fundamental departure from BCS theory. Your central paradigm of BCS theory due to this effect will still remain valid. Your TC will decrease, but that's all. However, there is another effect that comes in, and that is when you introduce disorder, then disorder scattering reduces the superfluid density. And since superfluid stiffness is proportional to the superfluid density, this will render the superconducting order more susceptible to phase fluctuation. And therefore, you can have fluctuations in the phase, and you can have a scenario where the superfluid stiffness becomes of the order of TC. So now let me come to our work. The superconductor that we chose for this study is niobium nitride. This is a very simple Gorin variety type 2 superconductor. It has a sodium chloride crystal structure, a TC of 16 Kelvin. It has a normal state when it's not disordered. In its ordered form, the normal state is a metallic normal state, and it follows BCS theory quite accurately. So What we realized is this system we can synthesize from the moderately clean limit, but continuously tune the disorder to very, very dirty limit in epitaxial forms of the film. So let me show you how we could grow these films. These films are grown through magnetron sputtering. You have here a single crystal MgO substrate, and we sputter niobium in an argon nitrogen atmosphere. And you have this epitaxial niobium nitride, which grows on the single crystal MgO substrate. Now, you can control the niobium to nitrogen ratio in this plasma by controlling, for example, how fast you sputter the niobium target. So, if you sputter the niobium a lot, you have a lot of niobium in the plasma, and what you get is not NBN, you get a different crystallographic phase, NB2N, which is not supernatin. Then you reduce the power of sputtering, so you have less and less niobium in the plasma, and exactly at the phase boundary between NB2N and NBN, you get the stoichiometric NBN. I will show you in my next few slides why this one is the stoichiometric NBN. And then if you further reduce the power, you start having niobium vacancies, and your TC gradually decreases. Okay, now I told you these films are epitaxial. You can see the cross-sectional TEM images. These are the lattice planes of MgO and the matching lattice planes of NBN. You see that for an ordered film, but you also see that for a considerably disordered film. So our disorder here is essentially atomic vacancies of niobium. Now, this is a very simple system, and as a result, one can estimate the electronic carrier density on the back of an envelope. So, the band structure was calculated by Matthes, and the conduction band consists mainly of the niobium 4D band. So, we know that niobium has five electrons per niobium atom. In the face-centered cubic structure, you have four niobium atoms, so that is 20 electrons per unit cell. You divide 20 by the unit cell volume, and this is your electron density that you would expect, which is 2.33 into 10 to the power 29. You do Hall effect measurement, and you find out the carrier density. And what you see is that this sample, which is the highest TC and at the phase boundary, has a carrier density that almost matches the theoretical carrier density within error bars. And then when you go to niobium deficient films, you are removing niobium, so you are removing electrons from the conduction band, and your carrier density gradually decreases. Your TC also consequently decreases. So this is how we tune the disorder. I'm sorry, I missed. Okay. So, however, we quantify here the disorder for each of these films through a parameter which is KFL. And I have one slide missing here. So, our disorder parameter is KFL, and we can estimate KF from the carrier density measured from Hall effect. Similarly, we can estimate L as Fermi velocity into tau, where tau will be estimated from the Drude formula and the experimentally measured conductivity N squared tau by N. And this parameter KFL, as you can see, is a measure of the mean free path in units of de Broglie wavelength. So therefore, large KFL is low disorder, and KFL 1 is notionally where all your block states are destabilized, and therefore KFL less than 1 should correspond to an Anderson insulator. So we can tune the KFL from about 10, which is our most ordered sample here, down to about 0.42, which is this most disordered sample here, and this is the entire zoo of samples. And you can see that the resistance varies by almost 5 orders of magnitude. Now if I blow up this low temperature region, as the disorder increases, you can also see that the TC gradually decreases. And here if I plot this red points, TC as a function of KFL, so TC monotonically decreases and asymptotically TC goes to 0 around KFL 1. So now in the next part of the talk, what I will do is, I will see how the superconducting state evolves as I approach this critical disorder for the destruction of superconductivity. Yes. You mean this one? This is not a temperature independent resistivity. This is the same curve that you have seen earlier here. This is the same curve that you have seen here. However, that was plotted in log scale, and that's why it's looking as if it's temperature independent. So the log that I showed you there is the same that you have here. Okay, this is in the log scale, that's why it's looking like this. Okay, so the first toy that I will be using to investigate the superconducting state is this scanning tunneling microscope, which is entirely home built. It has an in-situ deposition chamber where we grow our samples, and then with a set of two manipulators, so it goes directly in the STM, which is sitting at 2.6 Kelvin. We have now made a second STM, which is similar but with more capabilities, which goes down to 500 millikelvin. Now, this is the schematic drawing of our STM. The actual STM is sitting here, about 1.5 feet below the ground in this concrete block. And you have the sputtering chamber here. And these are the manipulators through which we can directly take the sample in the STM, which is sitting at low temperature. This is a blow-up of the head. This is how our sample holder is. The sample is at the bottom face of this. And you have the tip here. This is the post positioner. This project we had started with Shorin Mukhopadhyay, but he was a graduate student, but he could not complete in his PhD time. And essentially this STM was completed, and the second STM was fabricated by this guy, Anand Kamlapure, who is an outstanding instrumentation person, and I'm very lucky to have him in my group. Okay, so what did we do with the STM? We take an argon nitride film, and now along, let's say, this 150 nanometer line, we can take superconducting spectra at 32 equidistant points. If I put this spectra one up, after the other, we will get a 3D plot like this. But 3D plots are not difficult, rather difficult at least for me to visualize. So I will project this into 2D, where I will color code the conductance here. This axis is the bias voltage, which is this axis for a single spectra. And on this axis is the position. So you can see this red region will correspond to high conductance. So this is the coherence peak. This blue region is the gap where the conductance is low. And this is the normal state. When I will show you the temperature evolution, what I will do is I will average over all these 32 spectra and change this axis to temperature. So let me start with first a low disordered sample with a TC of 12 Kelvin. So here you can see that the superconducting energy gap actually disappears almost at the temperature where my resistance appears. But here is the remarkable result that we have. This is a sample with a TC of 1.65 Kelvin. You can see the TC from the resistance as a function of temperature here. But the superconducting energy gap seems to be persisting. A pseudo gap seems to be persisting all the way almost up to 7 Kelvin. There is a caveat in this measurement, and let me explain the caveat. The caveat is the following. Let's say if you take this sample with 2.6 KTC, and you look at the raw spectra, then it looks as if your superconducting gap is persisting forever. It's never going to zero. However, if I show you the raw spectra, the sort of individual spectra, then you notice that the superconducting feature is actually this low bias feature that you have here. But it's riding over a much broader feature, which extends up to very high bias, which is nearly temperature independent, and has nothing to do actually with superconductivity. This, we believe, comes from Altshuler-Aronoff kind of electron-electron interaction in the normal state, which is also giving me the negative temperature coefficient of resistance. So if we subtract this V-shaped background, I can replot the data here. And if I color code this back, then you can see that my The temperature at which the superconducting feature in the spectra disappears is around 7 Kelvin, which we call as T star. So now we have done this for several samples with varying disorder. This is the most striking one. You have no superconductivity down to 300 millik. However, this is the data from 500 millikelvin up to 8 Kelvin. You still have a pseudo gap that extends almost up to 7 Kelvin. We can also look at spatial variations. And for low disorder samples, the superconducting gap is more or less homogeneous. But as you go to higher and higher disorder sample, my superconducting state becomes more inhomogeneous and it starts forming as domain-like structures. So now if I summarize all these things in a phase diagram, what I get is this. Here the green points are TC, determined from resistance measurement. And then these blue points are this pseudo gap temperature T star. What you observe is that at low disorder, TC and T star are identical. But as you go to higher and higher disorder, and this I'm plotting as a function of KFL. So at higher disorder, I have this T star, which is more or less independent within error bar, around between 6 to 7 Kelvin, but the TC is gradually decreasing to 0. So I'm forming a pseudo gap state here, qualitatively very similar to the high TC pseudo gap that is observed. And one would be tempted to believe that this is resulting actually from phase fluctuation. Before I go further, let me also say that in this region, we believe that this is where the weakening of the pairing interaction is happening from the loss of screening. And this is reducing TC, the Anderson-Mutali-Bramer-Fishman kind of mechanism. However, that is not giving rise to any severe departure from BCS theory. You might have departure in details, but not in the central paradigm. Now, if this pseudo gap, which results from phase fluctuation, right now is just a conjecture, because I'm just looking at the amplitude. I'm not looking at the phase stiffness of the material. So for that, you have to do a second measurement, and which is the measurement of the magnetic penetration depth. So this is normal. Most of the measurement of magnetic penetration depth are not absolute measurements. They are measurements where you measure delta lambda as a function of temperature, and then you use some kind of BCS fitting to get the absolute value of lambda. This scheme would not work here because we are looking at physics beyond BCS. We have to get the absolute value of the penetration depth. And the technique that we use was actually pioneered by Lemberger in Ohio some years back. And this is the following. You have a primary coil here like this, and you have a secondary coil here. And you put a superconducting film, which is 8 millimeter diameter, a regular shaped superconducting film in between. So the field produced by the primary will get partially shielded from the secondary, and the degree of shielding will depend on the penetration depth of this film. So once you measure the mutual inductance of this assembly, you numerically solve the coupled Maxwell's and London equations for finite element analysis, and this gives you an absolute value of the penetration depth. So this setup in our lab was fabricated by Mindru Mondal, another bright student. And let me now show the variation of superfluid stiffness with disorder. So these blue points are the penetration depth extrapolated to T equal to 0. For me, T equal to 0 is actually 300 millikelvin and then extrapolated back. And then I calculate here J is the superfluid stiffness. I am plotting the superfluid stiffness as a function of TC of time. And here is the TC line. So you can see that for the low disorder sample, the superfluid stiffness is almost two orders of magnitude larger than TC, so phase fluctuations play no role. But as you approach stronger and stronger disorder, you have the superfluid stiffness which becomes of the order of TC. So you would expect phase fluctuation now to play a role. To see whether they actually play a role, we now look at the temperature dependence of the superfluid stiffness, of the superfluid density. Now, superfluid density is proportional to 1 by lambda square. So what I am plotting here is for various films with different disorder, I am plotting 1 by lambda square as a function of temperature. And we can see that for this low disordered sample, they follow almost exactly the DTBCS behavior, which is given by this expression here. But let's focus on these samples that you can barely see on this graph, which are the samples for which I start seeing the pseudo gap state appearing. So I am blowing up these three curves in these three panels, and what you see is that now there is a significant departure from DCS theory. The DCS curve is this black one, and you have, and now let me actually focus on this most disordered sample, where the departure from DCS curve is the most pronounced. So if I look at this most disordered sample, the first thing that I observed, that for an extended range of temperature, the superfluid density varies linearly with temperature. This is a hallmark of classical phase fluctuation. It is essentially spin wave-like excitation in, let's say, Josephson junction network. And at low temperature, the superfluid density tends to saturate. So if I look more closely, I observe that at low temperature, the superfluid density decreases as T square. So you have a T square dependence here going over to the linear T dependence at higher temperature. So what does one expect? Now, if I have quantum phase fluctuations, which comes from the number phase uncertainty principle, I would expect that the superfluid density will be reduced compared to the BCS value at zero temperature, and would remain temperature independent at low temperature. Then above a certain characteristic temperature, I will have a crossover to the classical phase fluctuation regime, which is a thermal phase fluctuation regime, where I will get a linear variation of superfluid density with temperature. Now, this is qualitatively what we observe, but with two caveats. The first caveat is that this crossover from quantum to classical phase fluctuation should happen roughly at the Josephson plasma frequency. And if I do a back of the envelope estimate of this Josephson plasma frequency, I get a ridiculously large number, which is actually much, much larger than my TC. The second thing is, of course, I never get a temperature independent superfluid density, I get a T square dependence. So first, let's understand whether I have actually quantum phase fluctuation and whether my superfluid density is suppressed compared to the BCS estimate. Now, in the absence of any phase fluctuation, there is a very neat relation in BCS theory between 1 by lambda square, the superconducting energy gap, and the conductivity in the normal state. And this is a beautiful expression because there is no fudge parameter here. These three are universal constant, and these two are measurable quantities. So I take my entire set of films, and through tunneling, we measure the superconducting energy gap, we measure the resistivity. And what I am plotting here now is, this is the 1 by lambda squared, which is estimated from this formula. And this is its purple points. These green points are the superfluid density that I measure. And at low disorder, these two match almost exactly. But as you go to higher disorder, you have the experimental superfluid density, which becomes lower than this BCS one. And actually, this is a log scale. So this difference of the most disordered sample is about 50%. And we believe that this suppression of superfluid density is a hallmark of quantum phase fluctuations being present in the system. Now, in the light of this, let's look again at the temperature dependence. Now, we have this T squared dependence going over to the linear dependence, and also we have this anomalous crossover, which is happening at much lower temperature than the plasma frequency. Now, in 2001, there was a very interesting paper by Ben Fato, along with Mohit, Arun, and I think maybe some others who are in this audience, who looked at the role of this low energy modes of dissipation on the phase fluctuation in a superconductor. And what they concluded was the following. In the presence of low energy mode of dissipation, the crossover temperature would come down drastically. And second thing was that the temperature variation of the superfluid density at low temperature, instead of being flat, would acquire a T-square dependence. This is qualitatively consistent with our observation. However, we have to ask ourselves whether we have any evidence of low energy modes of dissipation being present in the system. Now, a real direct proof of that would only come from complex conductivity measurements. So, maybe my conductivity measurements at microwave frequencies and higher, which we are in the process of doing, we haven't done that yet. But we have an indirect evidence, and the indirect evidence comes from this tunneling spectra on these planar tunnel junctions for films with different disorder. What we observe is that for low disorder film, they follow BCS theory very accurately. But as you increase disorder, there is a gradual shift of spectral weight from this coherence peak to regions below the gap. So you start forming mid-gap states, and we believe that this mid-gap states could provide modes of low energy dissipation. Okay, so now let me come back to the phase diagram again. So, we have this, so we understand now, I think, this region of the phase diagram where we have a pseudo gap resulting from phase fluctuations. Now let me concentrate on these three samples here where we have no superconductivity activity down to 300 millikelvin. Now there is one possibility is that these are just dirty metals or on the borderline of insulators. The other possibility is that you still have superconducting correlations here, but because of strong quantum phase fluctuations, you have destroyed the superconductivity down to T equal to zero. Now to explore this, we measured the magnetoresistance of these four samples. These three samples which are not superconducting and this one which has a superconductivity of 500 millikelvin. And what you see first, this is the sample which has a superconductivity around 500 millikelvin. You see that the magnetoresistance is canonical, it's what it should be. The resistance increases with increasing magnetic field. But for these samples which show no superconductivity, you see this pronounced peak in the magnetoresistance, which is very unexpected. Now, you have this pronounced peak in the magnetoresistance, which actually gets more pronounced as you go to stronger disorder. This peak has been observed in various systems like indium oxide, titanium nitride. This is not the first time that we are observing it. And one of the explanations was given by D.B. Mayer and Avishai. And what they said is that if my sample is consisting of superconducting domains, which are phase incoherent because of quantum phase fluctuation, then at low fields, the dominant current will pass through the superconducting puddles, and you have a subdominant current which will pass through intervening regions. However, as you increase field, the superconducting puddles will shrink in size, and beyond the point, when the size is small enough, there will be a Coulomb energy associated with electron transport within the puddles, and then you will have the dominant current flowing, avoiding the superconducting puddles, and only a subdominant current going through these puddles. And this peak demarcates actually the transition from this kind of transport to this kind of transport. So if that is the case, then this peak is inherently associated with the existence of superconducting puddles in the system. And what we do is we track carefully at the temperature where this peak disappears. And now this temperature, I am plotting it here, and you can see that this temperature where the peak disappears in the MRS data is not very different from the T star that we observe in the superconducting samples. So we believe that we have now a complete understanding of what disorder does, at least in iodine nitride. There is one regime here, the low disorder regime, where you have a weakening of pairing interaction from the loss of screening, presumably. The second region here, where you have a pseudo-gap state resulting from phase fluctuation. And at strong disorder, you have the superconducting ground state which is completely destroyed, but superconducting correlation nevertheless persists in the system in the form of the magnetoresistance peak that I showed. Do I have a few more minutes? Okay, so if I have two more minutes, let me just very quickly tell you about two-dimensional films. And this is where we observe the Costello-Stallis transition. Now, as we know that in a system, in a two-dimensional system with continuous symmetry, you cannot have a true long-range order. However, you can have a quasi-long-range order, which means that all your correlation functions decays algebraically, and the transition from this quasi-long-range order to disorder, where this correlation function decays exponentially, is called this Costello-Stallis transition. It's called the Costello-Stallis transition. Now, conventionally, the Costello-Stallis transition is understood within the XY model. And within the XY model, there is a very definite relation between the ratio of the vortex core energy, the energy required to create a vortex core, and the superfluid density, which is given by pi squared by 2. And for those who are familiar with RG, these are the RG equations that you solve to get the Costello-Stallis transition temperature. Now, if you solve this RG equation, what you expect is this, that the superfluid stiffness or the superfluid density should remain independent of temperature up to very close to the Costello-Stallis transition, and then at this transition temperature abruptly come to zero. Now, this is within the XY model. However, a superconductor has additional things, and the additional thing is quasi-particle excitation, which due to its superfluid density decreases with temperature even without any phase fluctuations in the system. So this is what you have in the absence of any Costello-Stallis transition. Now on the top of that, if you have a Costello-Stallis transition, then the superfluid density at a characteristic temperature will abruptly come to zero. Now, okay, so now what I'm showing you is superfluid density measured on four films with different thicknesses, and these are films which are not very disordered. These are in the clean limit. So my coherence length is about 5 nanometer. You see, for 18 nanometer, it follows BCS theory all throughout. Then for 12 nanometer, I see a small departure here. For 6 nanometer, a slightly greater departure, and 3 nanometer, a departure here. And you presume that these are this is a signature of the KT transition. However, this has remained controversial for two reasons. One is this jump is not very sharp, so this you could attribute to inhomogeneity. But more importantly, the Costello-Stallis transition from the 2D XY model should have happened at this superfluid density here. But you see the deviation from BCS is starting at a temperature which is lower and at a superfluid density which is much higher. So the question is this actually the Costello-Stallis transition at all? So to understand this, first we note that, as I have mentioned before, within the 2D XY model, you have this ratio of the energy required to create a vortex core and the superfluid stiffness. This ratio is pi squared by 2 by about 4.9. But this is considering only phase fluctuations as an excitation. In a superconductor, you also have the quasi-particle excitation, and therefore a better estimate can be obtained from the condensation energy. So if I use the condensation energy, and I use just these back of the envelope BCS relations, then I will see that the vortex core energy is actually of the order of J. It's not 5 times J as is given in the 2D XY model. So now to understand, what we do is that we take again the same RG equations, but we use this vortex core energy as a fitting parameter and see where we get the best fit. And when we do that, you can see that for a vortex core energy which is much smaller than what is given by the 2D XY model, we have an excellent fit of the data. This is the red line that is going through is the fit that we have. And of course, we have to introduce some amount of inhomogeneity, but the inhomogeneity is actually very small. It's of the order of 0.1% or so. Now, fitting the data is not enough, so we need a consistency check. And the consistency check is, now we, with this same scheme, we will try to fit the resistivity above the transition temperature. And this resistivity, of course, you have the Costello-Stolles transition and the mean field TC which are very close. So you have to interpolate between Costello-Stolles kind of fluctuation and Ginzburg-Landau kind of fluctuation. And this interpolation formula was given by Halperin and Nelson. And you can see that in this formula, you have this parameter which is B. This parameter B again depends on this ratio mu by J. So now we can fit the resistivity and see whether this mu by J agrees with the mu by J determined for the superfluid density. So this is the fit that we have now for the resistance as a function of temperature above TC. And now what I am showing you here, these green shaded parameters are the parameters that are determined from the superfluid density. So in the superfluid density, you have mu by J, of course, which is much smaller than what is expected from 2dxy and closer to BCS. And then using this mu by J, I can calculate what this parameter B would be here. And this is the value of B. Now these two parameters, this value of B is what I extract by fitting the resistivity data. And you can see that the agreement is actually remarkable for the 3 nanometer film. It's so good that one would think that it's accidental. But for the remaining two films, they are also within the same ballpark. So I believe that with this, we have been able to find finally a consistent description that explains the Costello-Stolles transition in real superconductors. Okay, thank you. Thank you.
But there is a but.
Yeah.
I'm astonished at your referencing.
Okay.
Actually, this is breakdown of the DCS paradigm in the vicinity of the superconductor insulator transition.
Yeah.
The existence of a gap at the transition and across the transition into the insulating state.
Yeah.
An insulator which was made up of phase and pairs was first introduced in the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research PhD thesis of Amit Ghosh.
Yeah.
10 years ago, and I'm astonished that you reference it once.
I see. Okay, I thought, it is referenced very often in my talks, but I thought that in this audience that's so obvious that I didn't bother to reference that.
Absolutely unfair to people who have done fantastic work 10 years ago predicting much of this.
Yeah,
and
okay. So, agreed.
This is a program that has continued on to this day, and there is a Nature Physics just last year,
yeah.
Very
poor than
Gendi,
yeah, okay.
And us. And I really feel that that work is not at all appropriately referenced.
Yeah, I agree, it's not proper, but I don't think I have put much of theoretical references here for the pseudo gap at all. So it's
true.
It's true, but my intuition was that this work was sort of absolutely well accepted, that it did not be referenced in every talk, but maybe not, so in future I will correct that.
I mean, you do have a weak gap state, so look at all the transition curves. Zero conductance only at the lowest temperature, so at higher temperatures you do have the mid gap state, so obviously
of course.
You are using this the model to extract your gap.
Of course.
So how
which one are you talking of?
Well, it's
so I am not trying to extract the gap everywhere. So for example, in this data I have not really extracted the gap. I'm just showing you the spectra. Where is the gap here? Where is the gap?
No, but these scans that you take, what is it?
So I don't have a model here really to extract the gap. One could in principle use a Dines fitting with an arbitrary gamma, a Brodin parameter, and extract some gap. But that is sort of an unphysical way of extracting a gap. You will have a Dines parameter, a Brodin parameter, which will be much larger than delta. So we have not attempted that.
You can just say that this is just a plot of the conductance. I mean, so
yeah, precisely.
Yeah, I think we are running at time, so I think
One last question. You see a peak, right?
Yeah, you mean in the magnetic resistance?
So superconductivity persists even at 845 Tesla, that particles you are saying?
Yeah, most likely. Means it would possibly persist up to at least the peak and somewhat beyond. That's what one would think. And right now we have some STM data which suggests that this is actually the case.
I'd like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to be here to participate in this wonderful meeting. And I feel privileged to be part of this August gathering to honor Professor T.V. Ramakrishnan. T.V. Ramakrishnan was, you know, instrumental in not only bringing up the theoretical physics in India, he was a boon for experimental physicists like us, material physicists. Often we find new materials with interesting properties. We don't know what to do because the standard theories don't work. You pick on him, we catch him, corner him, and then we have extensive discussions. And then we come back and he gives us new sight to look at certain experimental things. Things get better every time we have an interaction with him. I think this has happened over a wide, you know, large number of people, and I hope some of us, or maybe many,